The proportional mortality rate in both women and men. And what it shows that in the Asian Indians, the CV death was highest, both in the men and in the women. So the Asian Indian have a higher death rates from the atherosclerosis, cardiovascular disease, in comparison with the other Asian groups in the non-Hispanic whites. Now this is what is the addressing, what is called a residual cardiovascular risk. Here is the patients who are treated with smoking cessation, blood pressure control, control the lipids, physical activity. If you look at the patients with, say, coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease, peripheral arterial disease, the atherosclerotic abdominal aorta, aneurysm, and polyarticular disease, or all put together, you have a risk of 10% to 30%, which is residual risk, which is important, which need to be addressed in these patients. Now, this is the registry from Swedish country, which looked at people from 1998 to 2013, both between diabetics and a normal common population or a matched control. And what is interesting, that over the period of so many years with treatments of diabetes and treatment of blood pressure with antiplatelet drugs, we could reduce the hospitalization for cardiovascular disease to the tune of 27% in patients of diabetes. But what is disheartening is it's only 6% reduction in patients of a cardiovascular disease or a death. So therefore, we have not changed much despite of all this treatment. So beyond 2013, we have new drugs coming up, especially in 2015 at Sweden, we have the first empiric trial, which showed the benefit in terms of cardiovascular death. Now, this is the intensive versus standard glycemic control therapy, which looked at there's no clear effect on the mortality risk reduction, whether it's UKPDS, ACCORD Advanced Study, VADT study, all of them did not show much effect on the cardiovascular mortality, but though there was a microvascular reduction was there. In the UKPDS follow-up study subsequently showed some kind of a benefit in the cardiovascular death, and that was called the legacy effect in long-term control of hyperglycemia in patients of UKPDS. In fact, the ACCORD study showed increase in the death mortality by 26%, and therefore intensive control of glycemia did not change the cardiovascular outcome in these patients. Now, this looks at the mortality benefit demonstrated in the cardiovascular studies. The top studies are the one which have a glucose-lowering property and looked at the all-cause death with the EXCEL study, the LEADER study, the EMPIRE study. All of them showed the benefit. And below are all the studies which looked at the treatment with either a beta blocker or ACE inhibitor or mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. So all these drugs also showed benefit, but there was no anti-diabetic drug there. So therefore, amongst the diabetes treatment, the benefit in terms of reduction in the cardiovascular death was only described in the GLP analogs and the SGLT2 inhibitors. Now, this is the empiric findings. In short, it looked at three-point MACE, which shows reduction, relative reduction was about 14%, and the absolute risk reduction was 1.6%, which means the number needed to treat was 63. If you treat 63 patients, you reduce one patient with three-point MACE. The cardiovascular death, which was reduced by 38% in the EMPIRE-X study, and the absolute reduction was 2.2%. What is very interesting to see is the hospitalization for heart failure to the tune of 35%. This is the first time people started understanding or appreciating the heart failure, and suddenly the cardiologist started walking in the diabetology world where we started diagnosing more of heart failure. And these studies, especially the Savo-TIMI study, was the one which highlighted the hospitalization for heart failure. Incidence of worsening nephropathy was also reduced by 39%. And more than 40% sustained decline in eGFR was also reduced by 45%, and all-cause death by 32%, suggesting that these molecules these molecules, the SGLT2 inhibitors, were very cardio-friendly and they also renal-friendly. So the cardiovascular and renal events were reduced substantially. This is the snapshot of all the deaths, either because of cardiovascular, all-cause mortality, or hospitalization for heart failure, whether the patient has previous history of myocardial infarction or otherwise. You see that the benefits you get in all class of patients, though the p-value of interaction is not significant, but the line is before the line of unity, suggesting that it works in all patients, whether the patient has pre-existing myocardial infarction or does not have myocardial infarction to begin with. And this is again patients with or without history of stroke, whether you look at the cardiovascular death, all-cause mortality, and hospitalization for heart failure, again you see there's a benefit across the board in all patients, whether the patient has previous stroke or otherwise. Now this is the population of heart failure and no heart failure in the empiric study. Those patients who have heart failure burden, means who had a pre-existing heart failure at the baseline, or those who are hospitalized for heart failure, or a heart failure as the investigator reported adverse event. In all these patients, you have a reduction of 37% of mortality because of this. And those who did not have heart failure at the baseline also showed to the tune of 37% reduction in the heart failure. So therefore, this drug does work in patients who have pre-existing heart disease or a heart failure, or those who had no heart failure. So CV death reduction with empagliflozin was significant and consistent regardless of heart failure burden. Now, empagliflozin consistently reduced the CV death in type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease with or without prevalent kidney disease, chronic kidney disease. Again, you looked into cardiovascular death, hospitalization for heart failure, all-cause mortality, and all-cause hospitalization across the board. You have a reduction which is quite significant, and therefore those patients with or without pre-existing kidney disease, the drug worked well. So is the mortality benefit with empagliflozin in type 2 diabetes is too good to be true, was the editorial written by Sanjay Kaul in Circulation, and the CV death benefit with empagliflozin, robustness evidence for indicated approval, and a large CV death benefit across the population, 38% reduction, relative reduction, and 2.2 absolute reduction. The numbers needed to treat was 46. The substantial effectiveness is what the FDA said. Means you have two studies which should show reduction of p-value of 0.05, or one study which shows the p-value of less than 0.001, and that is called as a persuasive p-value. And large number of events studied, 309 CV deaths, consistent with the CV benefit and both doses, consistent benefit with various sensitive analysis. So they were first and only oral drug approved for reduction in the risk of a cardiovascular death in patients with type 2 diabetes with cardiovascular disease. So the FDA approves Jardiance to reduce the cardiovascular death in adults in type 2 diabetes is the US FDA announcement, which came in December 2016. And the standards of care in diabetes in 2019 said that when you have atherosclerotic disease, empagliflozin decreased 3-point major cardiovascular event outcome compared to the placebo.